Herzlich willkommen zu einer neuen Ausgabe von Crop FM. Der Titel der heutigen Sendung ist Lucifer's Lodge und mein Gast ist William H. Kennedy. Und wie immer gibt es natürlich den Cropcom, einen Live-Chat, mit dessen Hilfe sich Zuhörer dieser Sendung live am Gespräch beteiligen können. Erreichbar über die Website von Crop.fm, cropfm.mur.at, kein www davor, und dann auf Cropcom klicken. Ich sehe diesen Chat hier ein und reagiere auf Fragen, Kommentare etc. Ja, mein heutiger Gast ist William Kennedy. Hi, William. Hi, I'm fine. How are you?
Very nice to be here. Thank you for having me.
Yeah, thank you for coming on my show. By the way, something I haven't asked you. You wrote me an email, but how did you find my site? Did someone point it out to you?
I found your site just doing a general search of the internet, and I came across some older interviews you did.
Uh-huh.
And I'm very interested in the subject matter you present on your radio show.
Oh, great.
So I contacted you because a book I've written recently fits into the overall corpus of your program.
Great. And the book you've written is called Lucifer's Lodge.
It's Lucifer's Lodge, Satanic Ritual Abuse in the Catholic Church. And any of your listeners can get it at www.williamhkennedy.com. There's an H in the middle. If you put William Kennedy in, you'll get an American novelist who doesn't like getting emails that are intended for me. So it's williamhkennedy.com. And the book focuses on the crisis in the Catholic Church, which centers around various priests who were accused of molesting children and were also involved in various sorts of occult rituals as part of their abuse of women and children.
I see. And this book just came out in 2004?
Yes, it did. It came out last March, I believe. And my motivation for running it came from an interview I did in 1996 with Father Malachy Martin. Now, Malachy Martin may not be too familiar in Europe, but
I heard of him.
A Catholic novelist and a writer who focused on things like the New World Order and demonic possession and some of the more fringe elements that you might find within the Roman Catholic Church. I went to visit him in 1996 for an interview for a book, as I said. And he told me something very startling at the time. I'm from Boston, Massachusetts, and Father Martin lived in New York. He told me that Cardinal Bernard Law of Boston was running a pedophile ring of priests, some of whom were Satanists. Now, this was back in 1996, long before the Catholic Church crisis came into the popular media. And at the time, I really didn't believe it. I thought it was a very far-fetched or exaggerated thing to say. Now, just to fast forward a little, Father Martin died in 1999 of natural causes, And 3 years after that, in 2002, the Boston Globe broke a story that Cardinal Bernard Law was in fact running a ring of pedophile priests. Now, I was quite shocked. Father Martin turned out to be correct. And over the next year and a half, I just waited to see what would come out in the papers, if there would be any Satanism or occult rituals involved in any of these cases that were, you know, constantly coming out in the media. And I didn't have to wait very long. The first case that came out was that of Monsignor Frederick J. Ryan, who was the Vice Chancellor of the Archdiocese of Boston. And the Boston Globe found out that he had taken an underage boy to another state and had him tattooed with a devil figure on his inner thigh and sexually abused him. Now, in occult lore, that's called the devil's mark. It's an initiation mark you get when you join a satanic group. Now, I should point out that Monsignor Frederick Ryan was not a fringe priest. He was third in charge of the Archdiocese of Boston. So he wasn't just some lunatic out on his own. And he was also heavily involved with the production of child pornography, which I know over in Austria they've had a big problem with the seminary there,
yeah,
which demonstrates that this is very international.
Yeah, we had several such instances in the last years. So that wasn't the first one.
It's similar. What happened in Boston is similar to what is happening now in Austria and other countries too. This is a global problem within Roman Catholicism. Now, just to get back to my book, my book chronicles about five case studies of Roman Catholic priests who were involved in various forms of pedophilia and Satanism. And the next priest that came to my attention was a fellow in Ireland named Father Sean Fortune. And Father Sean Fortune was in Wexford, Ireland, and he would sexually abuse children. And when the parents of the children found out about it, they would confront Father Sean Fortune, and he would threaten them with satanic hexes. He would say, if you turn me into the police, your next child will be born disabled or crippled. He said, if you turn me into the police, Satan will haunt you for the rest of your life. Now, it's easier for us to kind of laugh at the rural Irish people who were intimidated by Father Fortune with these magical hexes, but they have a very different zeitgeist than the rest of us. They're very folk people. They're very rural people. And magic and witchcraft is a very, very real thing for them, as real as anything you can imagine that we consider real. So we can't judge them with the same standards that we would someone of people from a more modern and scientific worldview. Father Sean Fortune, this is the most bizarre thing they believed. Two of his detractors, two women who were complaining about his pedophilia, were walking across a field in Ireland, and they were both struck by lightning. And what Father Sean Fortune said the next day was, he said they didn't get half enough. He implied to the other villagers that he used his magical powers to strike these two women with lightning. Now, there again, to us, that might seem absurd that the other villagers would believe this, but they have a very different way of looking at the world. And as far as they were concerned, Father Fortune did strike those people with lightning. Now, as my book goes on, what I point out is that this problem isn't restricted to the United States or Ireland. It is a global problem within the Roman Catholic Church, which, as you were saying, in Austria, there's a very big problem at a seminary just outside of Vienna, where the seminarians there were producing huge amounts of child pornography. Now, I looked into the case in Austria, and there's no way really to determine if there was Satanism or occultism involved in Vienna, because all the photographs and records are right now sealed by the government as part of the investigation. They are not at this time available to journalists and researchers, which might be a good idea until they, you know, the legal authorities pull apart what is going on. But my prediction is that the seminary near Vienna will show that there was Satanism and occultism involved there. It will just take some time before those materials are released to the general public.
Do you think, I mean, I think if I remember correctly, it was in St. Pölten, which is the capital of a province. And do you think if they really find out that Satanism or satanic cults have been involved in this, that it will ever come out?
It most likely will, because the story has been broken already. It's inevitable that journalists in Austria and Europe in general will keep demanding that these documents and photographs be released, and they'll just keep putting pressure on the Austrian authorities until they let them have what they want. There has been, no one has come forward and stated that there's been any Satanism involved in Austria, but as I say, it's usually just a matter of time. Here in Boston, the first time that the story broke in January of 2002, it took 3 or 4 months before the story about Monsignor Frederick Ryan tattooing the boy came out. So it's just a wait-and-see thing right now. But my prediction, and you can quote me on this, is that there will be occult rituals attached with the problems in Austria.
Okay. So you see this as a global phenomenon that has been going on since when?
Well, that's really hard to determine, because the Catholic Church historically has been allowed to keep its records private. There seems to be a spike and an increase in this sort of activity right after the Second Vatican Council, which occurred in 1965. It's really hard to say whether it's a case of there was an increase in this sort of thing, or that since 1965 we just have the proper documents and the documentation to prove it. But at this juncture in history, it's safe to say that there was an increase since 1965 until the church is willing to release pre-1950 records, which they really don't want to do. I think personally this has always been a problem in the Catholic Church. The situation now is that I think this is the first time that the hierarchy of the church has been infiltrated by pedophile Satanists. And I'll give you an example just from my home state here of Massachusetts in New England in the United States. Now, as your listeners probably know, Cardinal Bernard Law of Boston was forced to resign as the Cardinal of Boston for protecting pedophile priests, many of whom were Satanists. Now, what you might not have heard is that another bishop in Massachusetts named Vincent Dupre, who was the bishop of the Springfield diocese here in Massachusetts, was forced to resign a couple months ago because he himself was a pedophile. Two people came forward and said that Dupre had molested them many years ago when they were children, and they did so because Massachusetts had passed a law saying that gay marriage was permissible, and Bishop Dupre of Springfield made a statement saying that all homosexual activity was evil. Well, these two men who he had sexually abused when they were children came forward and said Dupre is a hypocrite. He's a practicing pedophile himself, and yet he's out there condemning gay people who want to get married. And he really didn't reply, Bishop Dupre. He simply resigned. So what we're looking at is a top-level problem within the Roman Catholic Church, which goes right up to the Pope's office. There are people protecting pedophiles right in the Papal Curia, which is the Pope's council.
Now, you also wrote an article that I've linked up from the website. The website is the show website, cropfm.mur.at. And there, the title of the article is Threats in a New Millennium. And it's your most recent article, where you also describe, you trace back the roots of this, let's call it movement or whatever, back to the Second World War. Do you think that that's the time when, because one has to ask, the reason why I'm bringing that up is, one has to ask why is there, how could the structure exist in the Roman Catholic Church that prevents those priests from being prosecuted? And when I understand you correctly, you think that at the era of the Second World War, there was this usurpation, or there was this takeover, or how would you subscribe to that? Or?
What I would say is, after World War II, I personally think that there has always been some sort of cabal or conspiracy of abusive priests. I don't know exactly how it happened or exactly when it happened, but I do know in the 1950s and 60s that bishops and cardinals were being appointed who were completely tolerant of pedophile priests and protected by, if they got caught in one church, they merely transferred them to another church that was far away and did not inform any of the new parishioners that this sort of thing was going on. And then when they started to sexually abuse children again and were reported, the bishops and cardinals did the same thing. They just transferred the person once more. And we have documentation which supports this happening from the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s. And that is my proof that this phenomenon comes after the World War II period, quite simply because that is what the documentation from those periods state clearly and distinctly, that the bishops and cardinals were protecting pedophiles.
So what do you think happened in this period, or in the 50s, that certain people came into power that would protect pedophile priests?
Well, that's really tough to say. At the end of World War II, number one, you have to look at a lot of factors when you look at World War II. For example, Mussolini's Italy, much like Hitler's Third Reich, was inundated with occultists. You know, you have Julius Evola, who was Mussolini's mystical philosopher, who wanted Italy to convert to neo-paganism. And then Mussolini signed the Lateran Accord and hooked up with the Roman Catholic Church. But it's really hard to say whether there was some sort of secret agreement which allowed occultism to still flourish under Mussolini. Now, Heinrich Himmler in Germany actually hired Evola to work for the SS as a researcher into occultism. So what you're really looking at just before and during World War II is a strong level of occultism amongst the leadership of the Axis powers. And these Axis powers came to an agreement with the Roman Catholic Church. Now, it's my speculation, and I don't have documentation to prove this, and a lot of your listeners are free to take issue with me on it, but I think that's the juncture where the Catholic Church began to tolerate various forms of occultism within its own ranks. There were high-ranking priests and bishops who were loyal to Mussolini, and high-ranking priests and bishops who were loyal to Adolf Hitler. Now, I speculate that they took part of the occultism, which was certainly immersed in fascism. It's indisputable. I don't see how they could adopt fascism without having adopted some of these occult teachings and satanic teachings as well. There's no way you could really get along well with fascists unless you accepted and maybe were even initiated into some of their occult teaching.
So, well, this has been discussed on the show numerous times, that the Nazis, for example, were deeply involved.
Hello?
Oh,
we're having a little technical trouble. I can hear you now.
You can hear me? Okay.
Yeah, okay, yeah.
Well, this was discussed numerous times on the show, that the Nazis were actually deeply involved with occult sects and rituals, and the Thule Society, I'm sure you're aware of. That was more or less brought forward the whole Nazi party.
Well, sure. I mean, the Nazis were actually the political arm of the Thule Society originally. You know, Anton Drexler was who the Thule Society hired to found the National German Socialist Workers' Party. So just at the very core of National Socialism is occultism.
Yeah. And obviously, a lot of those, a lot of this ideology survived the German Reich, and maybe was even carried over the Atlantic.
Definitely so. Now, this gets into a very interesting area, and you can look at my article, Satanism Threatened the New Millennium, WilliamHKennedy.com, or, you know, Crop FM, your link. Your page has a link to it.
Yep.
But in that article, there's a section there on occultism as it manifested in American U.S. politics. And I refer specifically to an organization called the Skull and Bones Society at Yale University in Connecticut, in New Haven, Connecticut. And what the Skull and Bones Society is, first of all, I should say that in the last presidential election here in the United States, both candidates for the presidency, George W. Bush and John Kerry, were members of the Skull and Bones Society.
And what are the odds for this to happen?
I mean, the odds of that to happen are absolutely astronomical.
How many people do they accept in the society? I think 8 or 10 a year?
Well, you know what? I'll give a little brief history of the society to put it into context, and then you can understand how it links into the New World Order and even German and European occultism. It's really a fascinating story. The Skull and Bone Society was founded in 1832 by a fellow named Russell. What had happened at the time was President John Quincy Adams had banned Freemasons from public office in the United States because he believed they had inordinate power within the U.S. government. Now, Russell, who was a student at Yale University, went over to Germany for a year, to Heidelberg University, and he got a charter for a fraternity from an unnamed German student society which had Freemasonic ties. It's uncertain which one it was, but during that time there were many, many Freemasonic secret societies in German universities. But he came back here to the United States and set up the Skull and Bone Society as a student organization at Yale University. And what they do is they only accept 15 new members a year when they are in their third year. American universities, you go for 4 years instead of three in Europe. So on your at the third year, 15 students are picked to join the Skull and Bones Society. Now, historically speaking, these 15 students are from prominent American families who can trace their ancestry back to 1620 when the Pilgrims from England came to Plymouth, Massachusetts and founded the Massachusetts Bay Colony, which is usually historically considered the beginning of what we now call the United States of America. At least culturally speaking, they were very different from the other British settlers who were already here. But in order to be picked for the Skull and Bone Society, you had to have at least one relative who could be traced back to a Plymouth plantation in 1620. Now, over time, this became a super elitist organization, and the people who became Skull and Bonesmen in American history, it's just incredible. From 1832 till now, we have three U.S. presidents, Taft, Bush I, and Bush II, who were Skull and Bonesmen. Henry Stimson, who was the U.S. Secretary of War during World War II, was a Skull and Bonesman. Averell Harriman, who was a U.S. diplomat, was a Skull and Bonesman. All sorts of incredibly prominent people. Henry Luce, the founder of Time magazine, which is our number one magazine over here in the United States, was a Skull and Bonesman. William F. Buckley was a Skull and Bonesman. Just amazingly prominent people, all of whom who was very quickly assumed very prominent roles in the United States government and finance and commerce. It's quite incredible. There's a company over here that delivers packages in Europe called Federal Express, which was founded by a Skull and Bonesman as well. So you're looking at an incredibly complex organization. The Dulles, who founded the CIA, the Central Intelligence Agency here in the United States, was a Skull and Bonesman. So you have a very clear and distinct tie between the CIA and the Skull and Bones fraternity. Now, George Bush I was the head of the CIA before he became president. So this Skull and Bones Society is also intricately tied in with U.S. intelligence services, which, you know, is quite a frightening prospect when you consider that there's only about 800 Skull and Bonesmen alive at any one time. And they work for mutual aid with one another. Now, the tie-in with Germany and the German world is quite fascinating. First of all, the Skull and Bones got their charter from a German fraternity. And secondly, the next major link is that Prescott Bush, who is George Bush's grandfather, did business with the Third Reich through his company Brown Brothers and Harriman. And what he did was, during World War II, he had $3 million of Nazi money in one of his banks that was run by Brown Brothers Harriman. And under U.S. law, you were supposed to turn over all funds that were held by the German government to the U.S. government. Now, Prescott Bush did not do that. He kept this money hidden in a secret account and was discovered by the Department of Justice here and was brought to trial for, a war crime. But very mysteriously, they never filed charges against him. They just confiscated the $3 million. Now, what they were thinking he was going to do is if the Third Reich had won the war and the Nazis came marching down the streets in Boston and stopped off at the Brown Brothers Harriman building, what Prescott Bush most likely would have said is, oh, here's your $3 million. I've been holding it for you, which would have ingratiated him to the new fascist rulers of the United States. Now, Prescott Bush, President Bush's grandfather again, he was involved with many things that mimicked what the Third Reich was doing. He started the American Eugenics Movement, which was a movement to sterilize human beings who were considered unfit for reproduction, including Native Americans, African Americans, mentally disturbed people, alcoholics. They were actually paid to be sterilized so they could not reproduce. That was picked up upon by the Third Reich and their euthanasia program, which was the first series of exterminations in Germany, which Prescott Bush, in a letter they have somewhere, he made a vague reference to approving of what they were doing. Now, that's a major link. Now, another link between the Skull and Bones and the Third Reich comes after the war. A Skull and Bonesman who was in Germany st- stole a set of Adolf Hitler's personal silverware, you know, cutlery that you eat with, knives and forks, and cutting meat. And this set of cutlery has AH on the on them. They're like tapped into the silver. And this is what all Skull and Bones men now eat off of in the Skull and Bones fraternity. They have meals there once a week. They have a cook who cooks dinners for them. And they eat off Adolf Hitler's personal cutlery set. And the people who have eaten off it are people like John Kerry and George Bush, which is a very, very bizarre, bizarre set of circumstances. Now, what makes the Skull and Bones a satanic organization comes with their initiation ceremony. During their trial, when they go to become Skull and Bonesmen, the final thing they do is this very specific occult ritual, which is really what we would call a black mass. At the very end of their ritual, the Skull and Bones initiates, again including John Kerry and George Bush, drink either blood or wine out of a human skull, and they are taken into the inner temple of the Skull and Bones building, which is called the Tombs, which is right on the campus of Yale University. And there are three bonesmen who are dressed up in costumes. One is dressed as the devil with horns. The other is dressed as an anti-pope who has his foot on a skull. And the third is dressed as a black knight. Now, what this really is, it is an inversion of the Christian Trinity of Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. The figure with the horns is Lucifer. The figure dressed up like the Pope with the mitre is the Antichrist. And the Black Knight is Satan, the Accuser, which is a title of Lucifer. Now, the initiates kneel down before these three figures, and the Black Knight, who they call Don Quixote, goes over and dubs them a knight of eulogia. Now, eulogia was the Greek goddess of eloquence, which gives Skull and Bonesmen a link to things like Wicca and neo-pagan religions. Now, what these people go through, what that initiation rite is a black mass, and they owe their ultimate allegiance to the Infernal Trinity. Now, it does not matter if they take this as a metaphor. It does not matter if they never, ever perform a similar ritual again. I'm a Catholic myself, and from a Catholic perspective, you only have to sell your soul to Satan once in this life to have it binding for all eternity. So what these Skull and Bonesmen do is they take a vow of secrecy and silence, never to reveal the inner workings of the Skull and Bones Society, and to never publicly speak about or reveal the initiation ceremony. And as I said earlier, their ultimate concern is to promote each other in jobs and economic positions. This came to a head in the last presidential election when there's a program on TV we have here on Sunday called Meet the Press, which is hosted by a very good American journalist named Tim Russert. Now, Russert interviewed George W. Bush and John Kerry in separate interviews, and he asked them about the Skull and Bones Society and their relationship to it. Now, according to Skull and Bones Society rules, you are never to speak of the order to outsiders. And if it's ever bought up, you're supposed to leave the room. Now, what George Bush and John Kerry both did is they refused to answer the question. They evaded the question. They kept their oath to the Skull and Bones Society. George W. Bush said, well, it's so secret I can't talk about it. And John Kerry just changed the subject and said he wanted to debate Bush three times. Now, what that says to, you know, the rest of us, is that Bush and Kerry are still loyal to the Skull and Bones Society. They are still keeping their oath. which implies that their ultimate allegiance is to the Skull and Bone Society and not to the American people, which is what the president and a senator are supposed to be loyal to. It's quite interesting because George Bush claims to be an evangelical born-again Christian. Now, I've spoken to a lot of born-again Christians here in the States, and they confirm the fact that you cannot be both an evangelical Christian and a member of a satanic secret society. In order to be an evangelical Christian, you would have to renounce your vows to the organization and denounce, you know, the organization as a whole. Now, John Kerry is a Roman Catholic, and under canon law, to belong to a secret society where you take a blood oath is de facto excommunication from the church. So neither one of these men really did anything to denounce their allegiance to the Skull and Bone Society, which there again means that's where their ultimate allegiance must lie. Their adherence to Christianity or their claim to be Christian is it's just pure hypocrisy. Their ultimate allegiance is to the Infernal Trinity and to the Skull and Bones Society. Now, the Skull and Bones Society is part of what Malachi Martin called the Superforce, which was Malachi Martin's expression for the New World Order. It's very interesting because when you consider some of the outside organizations which are affiliated with the Skull and Bones, it becomes quite frightening.
Oops. Da geht dahin. Der ist jetzt plötzlich verschwunden. Okay, kein Problem. Wir werden jetzt eine kurze Musikpause machen. Und ich werde mein Bestes versuchen, William wieder auf die Leitung zu bekommen.
To sing a backwash song like a frying pan when the fire's gone. Driving my pig while the band's taking pictures in the grass. And my radio smashed, and I like pianos in the evening sun. Dragging my heels till my day is done. Saturday night in the captain's clothes. Tin horns blowing when my jewelry froze. Way back when my Cadillac pants going much too fast. Karaoke weekend at the suicide shack. Community service and I'm still the Mac. Shock of my finger, spice in my hand. I've been spreading disease all across the land. Beautiful air condition sitting in the kitchen.
Ja, und hier ist er auch gleich wieder. Hi William.
Oh, hello. Yeah, just to get back to where we were. John Kerry, as a Roman Catholic, cannot belong to a secret society which you take a blood oath, because that technically is against Roman Catholic canon law, as I said, and it's what they call de facto excommunication. It means that God has excommunicated you from the church if the church does not do so directly. So Bush and Kerry are both very hypocritical as far as claiming to be devout Christians. You can't be a Skull and Bones member and be a member of the of a Masonic-like organization.
Yeah. Now, William, I've got a question.
Sure.
You talked about some very, very intriguing details regarding the Skulls and Bones Society. And a lot of those, how did you learn from them? I mean, who was there a whistleblower? Or, I mean, there was also a young journalist, I think her name was Robinson.
Yes, that's where I got my information by a woman named Alexandra Robbins wrote a book called Secrets of the Tomb.
Yeah.
And she is a Yale graduate, And what she did is she just started calling up members of the Skull and Bones. You know, she got, it's easy to tell who are members because you can see them walking in and out of the Skull and Bones building. What she did is she called up like hundreds of them, and some of them were willing to talk and give her the details of the rituals and what went on in the organization. Others threatened to have her killed. So you have, you know, folk things sort of happened. And she got enough information to reconstruct all of the rituals and practices of the Skull and Bone Society. And that's a very good book that your listeners should really read. It's, there again, it's called Secrets of the Tomb. And it is written by Alexandra Robbins.
Alexandra Robbins, yeah.
Very excellent book. Yeah. Well worth reading.
Another train of thought that came popped up in my mind when I was listening to you is, wouldn't it be, I mean, obviously those secret societies you were talking of and are all involved also in strange sex magic rituals. Wouldn't it be a good way, if you want to keep your members loyal, if you tell them that they have to engage in whatever strange kind of sexual intercourse, and filming them, and then later on telling them, well, if you ever disclose what we are doing here and what we're up to, and we'll come to that in a second, then we'll just you know, expose this video.
Well, sure, that's one of the secrets of the tombs which has come out. Now, it's very unclear. There are two versions of sexual things that go on there. One version is that all initiates actually lie in a coffin, and they, I hate to say this, they masturbate, and they tell everyone else in the fraternity all of their sexual and personal secrets. Now, it is claimed, and I have no proof of this, that this ritual is filmed, and that if anyone ever, you know, goes out and they find out that someone has betrayed the Skull and Bone Society, they will release this video or at least release the secrets that were told.
So yeah, well, that would be enough, wouldn't it?
A strong bond of blackmail within the Skull and Bone Society. There's a tradition of blackmailing members. Now, Alexandra Robbins, when she wrote that book, she had to do so by promising never to reveal the names of the people who gave her the information. It was completely secret, and she's never let that information out.
Yeah.
I think that what I just said has some merit, because no one that I know of has ever publicly come out on television or in a newspaper and given their name, said they were a member of the Skull and Bones, and then started telling what all the rituals were. It is all done covertly and secretly, most likely out of fear of blackmail.
Yeah. Now, there seems to be this global, I mean, the Skull and Bones or the Thule Society that was in Germany are not the only groups that have, well, that would fall into this same realm and that have similar agendas. So this seems to be...
Oh, no, the Skull and Bones would be like the inner core of the New World Order, or what Malachi Martin called the Super Force. An extended organization which will be of interest to people in Austria is a group called the Bohemian Grove, which was founded in California, in San Francisco, in the 1870s. The Bohemian Grove have a club in San Francisco, and they also have a secret retreat in Northern California. This group has, it's another occult organization. They do a mock sacrifice every year to an owl god, where they take a body and they call it Care, and they have a very weird ritual where they burn this body to death in a mock sort of demonic ritual. Now, members of the Bohemian Grove, which is an outer core of the Skull and Bones, now, for example, George Bush and George Bush II are both members of the Skull and Bones, and they are also members of the Bohemian Grove, which I see as an extension of the New World Order and the Skull and Bones. Now, a prominent member of the Bohemian Grove will be a name very familiar to people in Austria. Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger California is a member of the Bohemian Grove. I believe he's from somewhere in Austria originally.
Well, he is actually almost from Graz. That's, he's, I think, 5 kilometers outside of the town where I am now.
Well, someone that close
around
to
the corner.
You is a member who grew up that close to you is a member of one of these secret organizations, the Bohemian Grove. Now, to any German listeners, Helmut Kohl is also a member of the Bohemian Grove. As I say, it's another secret occult organization where people in power meet yearly or twice yearly and discuss various ways to maintain and promote power, and they also have these bizarre occult rituals. Now, the third organization is a group called the Bilderbergers, which are in Europe, and though they're less occult, it has the same membership as the Skull and Bones in the Bohemian Grove. The third organization is called the Trilateral Commission, which is an international think tank which advises governments on how to run things. There again, it's all the same group of people: Helmut Kohl, George Bush, Arnold Schwarzenegger is now a member of the Trilateral Commission since he became governor. Now, it's interesting, the symbol of the Trilateral Commission is three intersecting sixes. It's 666, which will be very familiar to any Christians out there.
Actually, I heard this mentioned lately on a show on Coast to Coast, and I looked up the website, and it actually, yes, it is. You don't need a lot of imagination to see the three sixes. Yeah.
Oh, no, it's there. It's just slightly distorted. It's quite obvious.
There are three arrows, actually, but, you
know. There are three arrows, but they shape sixes if you look at them closely.
Yeah.
You know, there's no two ways around it. They've even showed it to, like, 5- and 6-year-old children and asked them, what numbers do you see? And they say 666. So it's not something people are, you know, imposing on their symbol. It's obviously something deliberate.
Yeah.
Now, just to break things down for you, there are 6 billion human beings on this planet. 4 billion of them go to bed every night without proper food or medical care. 2 billion people are treated fairly well. And the people who actually control all of the wealth and the means of production number maybe 1 or 2,000 who control everything on this planet, from banks to food distribution to armament. Anything under the sun involving human activity, they control. Out of this elite 1 or 2,000 people, about 400 or 500 of the top members who run things are also members of these secret societies, like the Skull and Bones, Bohemian Grove, Bilderbergers, Trilateral Commission, and a group we have in the United States called the Center for Foreign Relations. When you look at that and the fact that this top 400 or 500 out of 6 billion people control everything and are also involved in satanic and occult ceremonies, it is safe to say that the world is run by a satanic cabal. Now, everything I've just broken down for you, you can find in any encyclopedia. It's no secret. The mainstream media, which is also controlled by this, you know, core of 400 or 500 people, they will not talk too much about any of it. You know, you don't see many stories on mainstream television in the United States about the Skull and Bones or the Bohemian Grove. I've heard in Europe it's not much better. You don't hear very much about it. Yet these are the same people who run our countries. You know, like Helmut Kohl, like Arnold Schwarzenegger, who may be our next president. He is now petitioning to have the U.S. Constitution changed so that he can run for president. The Constitution says you must be born in the United States to be eligible to run for president. Arnold Schwarzenegger was born in your neighborhood, and he's come over here, and he wants to run for president. And through his friends in the Bohemian Grove, he is actually being successful at getting a petition up in Congress to change the law that you will only have to live in the United States for 20 years to be eligible to be run for president. And this is purely for Arnold Schwarzenegger. This has never been considered before. And, you know, I've enjoyed Arnold Schwarzenegger's movies over the year. I think he's a very funny and delightful man. But I don't feel comfortable with the fact that anyone from these groups, wherever they were born, assume positions of power anywhere on earth. I wouldn't want to see Arnold Schwarzenegger become the president of Austria because he belongs to the Bohemian Grove. I'm not discriminating against him because he is Austrian. I am discriminating against him because he is a member of an occult organization that runs everything. And there again, nationalism means nothing to these core 400 or 500 people who run the planet. It's mutual aid for one another to attain higher positions of power in political and economic situations throughout the world and positions.
William, I have one thing I'm a bit struggling with. Now, you also bring up Masonic organizations and what have you. Now, a lot of the Masons, I mean, really honestly, they think that they are doing this for the good of humanity. And I'm now talking about the lower ranking Masons.
Oh, sure.
And now, when we talk about people like Arnold Schwarzenegger, Helmut Kohl, etc., do you think that those people are really aware that they are consciously signed up with the devil to gather more and more power and do evil things, or do you think that those people actually think that they are doing something good?
Well,
I mean, is this
a conscious in English? The road to hell is paved with good intentions. I don't know if they have that expression in Austria.
Oh yeah, we have it.
The road to hell is paved with good intentions. So, you know, Arnold Schwarzenegger and Cole and Kerry and Bush and, you know, whoever else you want to point out who's in these groups.
Because I have to say, I quite liked Kerry.
What? I like him too. He's a senator from my state. I've met him. I've spoken with him. I don't have a lot against him as a person. But I'll tell you this, if he wasn't a member of an elite organization or affiliated with a member of an elite organization, he would not have been allowed to run for president.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
And I'll give you a quick example. Bill Clinton, our last president, who I also kind of liked personally, he was a member of a Masonic group in his high school in Little Rock, Arkansas, called the Des Moines. And he was the head of his high school of the Masonic youth group. So when you look at all these people in positions of power, if they're not affiliated with these sorts of occult groups themselves, then they are controlled by people who are members of these occult groups. And as far as what they, how they actually interpret the initiation ceremonies, like at the Bohemian Grove or at the Skull and Bones or at the Bilderbergers, that is really irrelevant. It really doesn't matter if they don't believe in Satan. It really doesn't matter if they think it's just a frivolous ritual that they must go through in order to, you know, get in a position of power. At the end of the day, they go to these places, you know, the Bohemian Grove. These people meet every year, and they take the time to put on robes, and they take the time to go march out in front of a giant owl. And they take the time to, you know, drag this fake dead body onto a funeral pyre and set it on fire and give praises to the owl god. Now, Helmut Kohl, he's not going to go on German or Austrian television and particularly tell you this. And Helmut Kohl himself might think this is kind of a stupid ceremony he had to go through. But in order to maintain a high position of power and authority, he had to do it. Now, as a Christian myself, I look at this and I say, these people are paying allegiance to the infernal realm. You know, and what they particularly think about it is irrelevant because they still go there every year and do it, especially the Bohemian Grove. It's unbelievable. You know, there's a good website, Infowars.com, and it's run by a Texan named Alex Jones here in the States.
Yeah.
And he has a wonderful film called Inside the Bohemian Grove. He actually snuck in there and filmed their ritual ceremony.
Yeah. I've read about this in a book called Them, written by Ron Johnson. Have you ever heard of this English gentleman?
I have heard of it.
Yeah,
and
it's brilliant.
That's another book that does similar things to what Alex Jones did.
Yeah, actually
it just chronicles their rituals and why these people in positions of power are involved with them.
Yeah. Well, actually, I think Ron Johnson's book is really fascinating because he is a guy who actually took – he wanted to, as the English would say, take the piss out of the whole thing. He wanted to – you know, he just wanted to see – I think he wanted to look at it as a from a comedian perspective. But then – and he was getting – into all those mystical beliefs and so on, and especially conspiracy theories. And in the course of his book, I mean, he at one point gets chased by I think the Bilderbergers. It's quite some time ago that I read it. So it's a really fascinating book because at the end of the book, this guy says, who has nothing to do and who was never interested in the whole thing, he says, well, you know, whether you believe it or not, but something really dodgy is happening here. So
well,
I really
why do they hire thugs, you know, really mean, tough men? If you go up to the Bohemian Grove and you sneak into their area...
As they did, Alex Jones and Ron Johnson, yeah. And
like those guys did.
Yeah, great.
It doesn't matter what you think of that organization. You're going to find yourself being chased off and threatened.
Yeah.
Perhaps even arrested.
Exactly. Yeah. That's what happened to them. I mean, they were just trying to find out about the Bilderbergs, and they were just really harassed suddenly. And then so he goes, well, hold on a second. You know, if this is just all, you know, if this is just all nonsense, then why are we being harassed? So, you know, there must be something to it. So
well, I can tell you an experience I had. I went down to Yale University and had a camcorder, a friend of mine, me and a friend, and we were just walking around filming the tombs, the actual temple they have, and campus security came up and asked us, what are we doing? And they escorted us off the property, and they confiscated our video cassette and took it and said, if you come back here, you'll be arrested and sent for jail for trespassing on private property.
That's very strange. I mean, I just imagine someone filming on the campus of Graz, of the Technical University, and being arrested. I mean, that's hilarious.
it's unbelievable.
Yeah.
And they took our driver's license and wrote down all the information about us. Now, here's the interesting thing that I found out later. The Skull and Bones organization is under a political entity called the Russell Trust. And the Russell Trust technically owns all of the property that Yale University sits on. So if the Russell Trust or the Skull and Bones Society, they could evict Yale from its campus legally. So anyone who, like, if you go to Yale and ask a professor about the Skull and Bones, they'll say, look, I don't know anything about it. They're very evasive. And a friend of mine who's from Germany went down there to lecture. He's at Harvard University now. I don't want to use his name without asking him. But he went down there to lecture in the history department, and I told him about the Skull and Bones, and he asked the professor there about it. And what the professor of history said is like, look, if you want to be invited back here, don't ever ask that question again.
Yeah.
So why are they being so evasive?
Yeah. I mean, yeah, quite clearly something, you know, something's going on here. No, there's no question in my mind about this. The question is what? And also, what we're coming to the end of the show. We have about another 10 minutes. And what I would really like to get into is, what do you think is the motive? I mean, those people, Arnold Schwarzenegger, take Helmut Kohl, take any one of those people, take Bush. I mean, they have more money than they can ever spend in their whole lifetime. They have everything they want. What else is it that those people are looking for? Why are they doing this, actually? That's what I'm asking.
Well, you have to keep in mind, Tarek, that money in and of itself can only bring you so much power in this world. In order to attain more, what money is it's power and control over other human beings. The more money you have, the more power and control you have over other human beings. But there's a point where, to get more power over other human beings, you must leave the sphere of finance and move into the sphere of politics. For example, the richest man you can think of cannot order troops into another country to attack another politician they do not like. I'll give you two examples here in the United States. Ross Perot, who ran for president a few years ago, was a billionaire. And Pierre DuPont, who's the heir to the DuPont chemical fortune, is also a billionaire. The only way they could get more power over other people was to run for president, and that's exactly what they did, and they used their own money to do it. So I guess the point, just to clarify that once again, money will only bring you so much power over other people, and then you must attain political power to get more control.
All right. I mean, obviously, some people won't get bored of this. Now, as we are at the end of the show, I would also, in your book, you talk about the solar temple mass suicides and the serious cults and so on. And what I would like to ask you, because now I'm aware that this subject is already weird enough without bringing UFOs into the whole field.
But, oh, right, yeah.
But still, it is something that I'm very interested in, and I never heard you commenting on this. So what is your opinion about the connection to the UFO phenomena, whatever it is, and this phenomena we are observing here? And also, have you ever heard of a gentleman called Signore Balducci?
I haven't heard of Balducci, just to answer that.
Let me give you a short... What he did is, 1998, on Rai Television, he openly spoke about the UFO phenomena, and he said, well, those beings are here, and they're not harmful, something a lot of people would not agree with him, and more or less... talked very openly about it and acknowledged the existence of this, which was in 98, where, you know, that was a big thing by this time. So that was why I brought up Balducci.
Okay, well, my opinion on the UFO phenomenon on the whole, and this is purely my opinion, and you're allowed to disagree with me, I think the whole UFO phenomenon is diabolically generated. As a Christian, I believe that. I don't think UFOs are visitors from other planets, quite simply because, according to biologists, it would be impossible for other beings like us to be generated on another planet. So I think the whole UFO phenomenon is demonic. A lot of people disagree with me on that, and they're certainly entitled to, but I haven't seen enough evidence myself to convince me that UFOs are real and visitors from other planets. And I also want to point out that I first started studying UFOs in 1975 when I was 11 years old, when I saw the film Chariots of the Gods by Eric von Däniken.
Okay.
So it is something I've studied a lot myself, and I just believe it's diabolical, personally.
And if you say diabolical, so you think that someone is create or something or whatever.
I think it's Lucifer, and he's using UFOs or things that look like UFOs and aliens as a means to confuse human beings. And historically speaking, if you read medieval accounts of incubi and succubi, they sound very, very much like these, alien abduct. abductee testimonies. I was friends with John Mack, who was a doctor at a hospital who just died.
I heard of him,
accident.
Yeah.
And I used to discuss the comparisons between alien phenomenon, UFO abductions, and demonic visitations. And he said, we disagreed. He believed that the medieval people just mistook aliens for devils, and I'm saying they, in our days, were mistaking devils for aliens.
All right, so you say it's the other way around, really.
Yeah, and I greatly respected and liked John Mack. I always enjoyed visiting with him. We always met at a place called Seven Stars Books in Cambridge, Massachusetts, which has a lot of occult and UFO books. But that's one area we disagreed. But I should point out we never divided on it. We always remained good friends. And he had a lot of interesting things to say. And it's very tragic he died so young in London in a car accident.
All right. So, I mean, I kind of expected this position of you because a lot of...
that's fine. That's okay.
No. I mean, a lot of... you're clearly coming from a Christian point of view, and a lot of... people would take this position who are traditional Christians. I've heard this is not the first time I heard it, and I'm totally, you know, I don't know what it is. So I mean, you could be totally right. I don't know.
That's fair, and I'll tell you, someone else who took your position was Father Malachy Martin. He wasn't sure if we were being visited by aliens from another planet. He thought it could be possible. But he also thought it could be diabolical or evil as well, or he thought it could be a mix of the two.
Yeah.
So it's a perfectly valid position to, you know, not commit yourself to one side or the other.
Yeah.
That's logically consistent until more evidence is presented.
Exactly. I mean, that's actually my personal opinion on it, is that it's a mixture of two, of both.
Yeah. Interesting. I mean, like I say, I get in this debate quite often, as you can imagine.
Oh, yeah.
And there's an entire range of views out there, and mine is just one of them. I'm not saying I'm absolutely correct. A UFO could land outside my door tomorrow, and the aliens could come out and stick their tongue out at me and say you were wrong, and I would concede that I was wrong.
Yeah. That would be interesting, wouldn't it?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Now... last thing for tonight.
Sure.
Unfortunately, it was very fascinating.
Well, I can come back someday.
Oh, yeah. That would be good. The Secret of Fatima. I mean, I know. It's far too big subject to be brought up, but I just would like to kind of squeeze it in here. A lot of people say that this this demolition of the church, that in some ways happened through those cases and is happening, was foretold in the Third Secret of Fatima. Now, what's your personal take on this?
My personal take on when the Vatican allegedly released the Third Secret of Fatima, I don't think they gave the whole thing. I think it's part of a cover-up. There's much more to the Third Secret of Fatima, according to people who saw the actual documents and heard about it. The corruption of the church certainly was predicted at Fatima, and we are certainly seeing it. But I really don't want to comment on the Third Secret because I believe the Vatican is still retaining part of it. They haven't released the whole thing. And there again, that's just my opinion.
And probably for a good reason? Or?
For example, Father Malachy Martin was present with Cardinal August Beyer, who was a high-ranking German Jesuit cardinal who he worked with in the 1960s when the new pope read the document. And Beyer revealed to Malachy Martin what was in that document, and Malachy took an oath never to reveal what he was told. But he told me the information that was given in the Third Secret of Fatima. If you were to write it out, you know, in regular script on regular paper, would take you about 3 or 3.5 pages in order to write out. He told me the size of what the Third Secret of Fatima was, And what the Vatican released was about, I think it was a page and a quarter, if you were to write it out by hand in normal writing. So the size of what they released doesn't connect to what I was told how long the actual document was. And I also heard this from another priest who has since passed away, who was an assistant to John Paul II, who also read the document. And I asked him, I didn't tell him what Malachy Martin said, but I said, roughly how long writing would the third secret be? And he said, oh, about 2 or 3 pages.
Yeah.
So the actual physical size of what I was told doesn't match with what the Vatican released, and those are my reasons.
Yeah, fascinating. Yeah. Well, all right. I mean, there's so much I would like to go into with you, but maybe we can do it another time.
Well, if I'm invited back, we could go into some other
Yeah. Like the Frankist, for example, and their ties
thank
to Austria.
For
yeah. All right. Well, thank you for being
Very
on my
good.
Show, and I'm sure we'll talk again.
Very good.
Okay. Thanks. Bye.
Bye.
Okay, das war also William Kennedy, live aus Massachusetts. Und ja, also das ganze Thema, ich habe in den vergangenen Tagen in der vergangenen Woche habe ich sein Buch gelesen. Und ja, es ist also durchaus interessante, er hat also sehr viele Fakten hier zusammengetragen über das ganze Thema und versteht es auch, die relativ gut zu verbinden. Kommt natürlich aus einer traditionellen katholischen Sicht, aber ist auch eine durchaus interessante Sichtweise des Ganzen. Ja, das nächste Mal Crop FM findet am 21. Jänner 2005 statt. Also die nächsten beiden Male werden ausfallen. Weihnachtspause und so weiter. Ich werde wahrscheinlich Wiederholungen spielen. Was genau, weiß ich noch nicht. Die nächste Sendung wäre ja interessanterweise genau am 24. Also da muss ich mir jetzt wirklich was Gutes ausdenken, was ich da wiederhole. Die heutige Sendung hätte nicht schlecht gepasst, aber naja. Ja, die nächste Live-Sendung findet dann am 21. Jänner 2005 statt und ich freue mich, Konstantin Meil bei dieser Sendung als Gast begrüßen zu dürfen. Und es wird wieder meine Sendung auf Deutsch sein, nachdem jetzt schon einiges auf Englisch war. Ich glaube, die letzten drei. Und in dieser Sendung mit Konstantin Meil geht es dann um die Sendetechnik der Götter. Also Konstantin Meil ist theoretischer Physiker, der sich mit Dingen wie Skalarwellen beschäftigt. Äußerst spannend. Und er glaubt also, dass er Hinweise und Beweise dafür gefunden hat, dass in uralten monolithischen Bauwerken, also Stonehenge oder, nein, ich möchte mir jetzt gar nicht vorgreifen, es gibt einen Fund in Vorarlberg vor allem, also auch Jahrtausende Jahre alt, wo er also glaubt, dass es hierbei sich um eine Art Kommunikationsmedium gehandelt hat. So zumindest habe ich das verstanden und ich bin jedenfalls schon sehr gespannt, was er dann selbst dazu zu sagen hat. Ja, ich bedanke mich fürs Zuhören und für das Interesse.